I don't want to be too elementary here, but some of you know that there's basically two broad schools of thought when it comes to making decisions about what you should invest in. There are those who have a technical view on that subject. It's called quote-unquote technical. Then there's the other that are fundamentalists. Well, fundamentalists are those who focus on, kind of as the name implies, those basics, things we'd readily recognize as being important to the health of a company. You know, how well is its industry doing generally? Is there a demand for its product? Is there a demand for its service? What's the quality of its management? What are the historical cash flows? Have we seen an upward trend in sales? What are their expenses for raw materials and other such things? You know, looking at those very basic sort of common sense metrics are the things that people who take a fundamentalist view consider when they're making investments. That appeals to me. I think it appeals to more intelligent investors, but there is this other school of thought that looks entirely at graphical data, at statistical data. They look at trends, and they will argue that they can ignore completely all those things that I just discussed and instead focus entirely on these trends and movements of stock prices and make decisions about what's going to lie ahead. I won't go into a lot of detail as to how that might make sense, but there are intelligent people who hold that view. But I think if you instead focus on the fundamentals of the securities you own, and without being too analytical, and just ask yourself, is there something here that would account for this diminution in value other than just the current economic conditions? And if the answer is no, it's just the current economic conditions, then you ought to consider staying with it. Now, some of you, incidentally, may be involved in real estate and you're concerned about your houses. Again, I think that message has to be the same. And I'd go further than that. Those of you who are looking for an investment to go to now, I think that for the same reasons it might make sense to buy a stock when you perceive it to be at the valley or at the ebb of its fluctuations. You know, for the same reasons you might consider some real estate investments. You know, right now Miami is experiencing this incredible glut of condominiums, and I'm using this as an example, where their condos are selling for 50 cents on the dollar. Many of these are new high-rises that are available, some less than that. And right now there are these venture capital funds that are coming in to buy from these developers who have these half-built towers, and they're out of cash flow, and the bank is unhappy with its predicament. The developer's unhappy, and these venture capitalists, some call them vulture venture capitalists, but they come in with the determination to buy at nothing more than 50 cents on the dollar, in some cases 30 cents on the dollar, and they've been kind of hovering around waiting for the pain to get to that point where the banker and the developer are willing to make the concessions to do the deal. And right now those deals are just starting to happen in cities such as Miami. It's taken, well, we've seen complaints about that market for a year and a half to 2 years. Only now has it gotten to the point where these venture capitalists are getting the very, very low numbers that they want to come in and finish the development. And let's face it, I mean, to buy a half-built tower and to complete it under these economic conditions does require, you know, a lot of risk, the assumption of risk. And as a result, you might imagine you can certainly defend the position of these venture capitalist funds that they're going to only buy at a maximum of 30 cents on the dollar, for example. They need that to allow for the possibility they're going to complete this tower, pour more money into a losing proposition, and then be in a situation worse than the people from whom they bought it. But I just call your attention to deals like that because this is the time to be thinking about it. And unfortunately, the opposite happens. Now, I realize that a lot of people aren't in a position to where they can come in and take advantage of those deals. Cash is king in this market environment. But for those who can put together the dollars and who have the courage to do so, to go into markets where there's incredibly depressed prices, you know, they can get deals that will become very sweet over time. Arizona is another area that Phoenix market has been overbuilt. And many of you know of other places. Some have not declined as much, perhaps because they didn't appreciate as much. But you ought to look specifically at those where the best opportunities lie. And don't be driven by the non-economic factors, by places that you may prefer or that may be more prestigious or might have these other advantages. Now, if you're buying for those other advantages, for those non-financial reasons, then fine. Then the financial reasons will take the back seat. in your list of criteria. But for those of you who are making a financial decision and looking to invest in real estate, I think that a wonderful market is these secondary vacation markets, which have taken the greatest hit. We will recover, despite what you're seeing now. And you're hearing this from someone who's not excited about the next 4 years. But nonetheless, I'm optimistic. I know that at the end of the day, our economy and the world economy will succeed. So these are just some thoughts. One other thing let me mention, though, and this is a general comment on securities. I know everybody has a theory as to what you should do with your portfolio and your stocks. And there's something you need to be aware of, that those who are insiders in the industry have recognized now for better than a decade. And that's what's called modern portfolio theory. Modern portfolio theory has been around for a while, but it's only gained really predominance from the inside, from the intellectual centers of the investment community over the last 10 to 15 years, I would say. But modern portfolio theory argues that, look, the markets are very efficient and no one has the ability to predict the market individually. No one can over time, I'll put you this way, no one over time can perform better than the market. No one. That's what this theory says. Now, I use the word no one because you can have blind luck, but no one can consistently do it. So in that sense, it's true. So you may be thinking of examples of people that you've known over the years who've become investment gurus. But if you think of every one of those examples, and I challenge you to think of an exception, they all fell out of favor. In other words, they went through this period of time when they were consistently picking winners and they were geniuses. But I guarantee you that time ran out and they ceased to be, and the spotlight went on someone else. If you think about random luck or performance, you would expect to see the same sort of phenomenon. Now think about it. Say that you're flipping coins. Would you expect to find a period of time during which somebody would have 10, 15, 20 heads in a row? Would you expect that to happen periodically? Of course it would happen periodically, even in something randomly such as that. And the reality is that there's so much information incorporated into the value of a stock. It incorporates all the historical performance, the opinions of investment fund managers, people who are sitting around all day long with all the information that's available to assess the performance of this, and the intersection of those opinions of the buys and sells, the highs and lows of those judgments is the stock price itself. That's that intersection of all those collective judgments. And those collective judgments are going to be the best opinion at that moment about what that stock's going to do. And no one who says, I know that it's worth 20, 30% more, for example, will consistently be correct. They'll be correct occasionally, just like your uncle or anyone you know may have made some shrewd stock decisions. But what the random walk theory is called, it's called the random walk, meaning the notion statistically that there's no way to consistently predict the performance of the market. So what that says is that all these efforts to market for your dollars, every stockbroker that gives every seminar, everyone you're listening to talk as authorities on Bloomberg and Wall Street Journal and other places, all those people know no more than the market. And if you challenge this, and this what I'm telling you does seem counterintuitive, And you at first think, well, that can't be right. Surely there's an ability to outsmart the market over time. But those who are proponents of this school of thought, and they're at the best universities, a lot of people in academia, but not just in academia, but they're the ones who've done the research. Let's face it, no one else is going to do the research to establish this theory. But they've gathered this data over many decades, and it's a pretty compelling case that no one consistently beats the market. And it does seem a little crazy because you're thinking, gee, I'm hearing someone talk about investment strategies. There are columns in every newspaper. There are columns in every magazine. You know, I watch all these financial shows and everyone eagerly asks the opinion of these experts. How can it possibly be that it's all nonsense? But I'm telling you that there is a very reputable line of thinking that in fact is the predominant line of thinking regarding investment portfolio management called modern portfolio theory, that says that you can't outsmart the market. So what you do is you invest in thing, and you spread your portfolio over a range of investments.